So I suppose when our management committee were planning the conference in conjunction with the staff, we were trying to come up with a team of speakers that would have been of interest and that people would be interested in hearing. And one of the people who were top of that list was our next speaker, and that's Mr. Gordan Jeyes. Gordan is the National Director for Children and Family Services with the HSE. It's a post that was created in 2010. And the role of the post is, I suppose, to coordinate the services in relation to children and families at a national level. So it gives me great pleasure to welcome, first of all, Gordan Jeyes to Donegal, and to look forward to hearing him here this morning.
It's good props up here, isn't it? As predicted, I've now been in post for 4 months, so if I'm not confused by now, I've not been paying attention. I was brought in to set up a reform programme, particularly in the social work and social care area, but covering the whole continuum. I argued right from the start that that would not be possible unless I had full accountability. So I wasn't fully paying attention, because I think accountability without resources is somewhat challenging at the national level. And of course, most resources remain local and regional. I'll return to that at the end, and there's a handout that I can make available to the conference organisers for people to pick up, because that's not my main purpose in being with you today. It's to celebrate your achievements and to stress my commitment to the importance of early years work. And just, it's interesting, for the past 6 years I have been a guest worker in Scotland's southern peninsula. So when working in Cambridge, I often struggled with my... I thought I spoke English until I went and worked in Cambridge, and then would find certain words and phrases. So I presume the 3 R's are familiar to people in terms of education had to be reading, writing and arithmetic. For me, in children's services, the 3 R's are important, but they're about rights, responsibility and respect, and making sure that in all we do, the child is the focus of our activity and is central. What impact is this having on the child and in the opportunities for the child? And that certainly applies in the early years sector. In Stirling, where I was Director of Education and then the first UK Director of Children's Services, we established fully integrated early years provision. And part of that was regular consultation with the children themselves, up to and including the extent where they influence policy. We asked the children in all of the nurseries to put smiley or grumpy faces depending on where they like to be within the nurseries. And a remarkable number of the smiley faces went outside. You know, that's where they wanted to be. And unlike sunny Donegal, now and again in Stirling, it rains. And therefore, resourcing changed, because nurseries bought Wellingtons, bought Plastic Macs, bought stuff so that they could be outside, because that didn't bother them particularly. So in terms of the policy inside out, much of it was influenced directly by consultation with children. As people involved, whose absolute commitment is to children's services, not to education, not to social care, but to children's services, you know, then we represent a continuum of needs. There's been a child in this before, because there's a piece of chewing gum down here. That's interesting. It's to keep me in my place, probably. So there's a continuum of needs, but it's too, you know, and we're irritating in that sense to the adult world, because the adult world organises services vertically. Here is mental health. So child and adolescent mental health becomes a Cinderella. Here is disability. Here is education. And we all know that secondary schools, the alpha and omega, the beginning and end of every aspect of education, and the rest of us are just born to serve the needs of secondary schools. But we know that children's lives are not like that, and that it is not possible to distinguish amongst their needs. That we will not achieve our best if we're not healthy. We will not achieve our best if we're not loved. We will not achieve our best if we don't feel safe. So separating those issues, education, care and health, it's just not possible. It's not logical, and it should be planned together. If we look at when a child is learning the most, it's in the first year of their life, but we wouldn't say the predominant issue for that child is education. It's how we take it forward. If I was to do one thing in Ireland that was going to raise achievement in schools, it would be absolutely make sure women don't smoke in pregnancy. Because low birth weight, slow start to school, late development, and that can impact throughout a child's life. But try telling that to the secondary head teacher that the most important resource initiative can be making sure that there are healthy pregnancies. So the continuum of needs is there, and sometimes the debate about what matters most is irrelevant. It all matters if we are going to help all our young people to become effective and efficient citizens capable of full economic independence. So making sure we are aligned, making sure our vision is clear, making sure our response is integrated, built around the needs of the child and the impact on the child is crucial. And my challenge to you is, yes, there are more to do, but look how far you've come. Look at these images from 10 years ago. Look at the investment that's been available. And the challenge has got to be beginning, are the sum of the parts, or the sums of the parts, if I'm keeping equivalent to what you're achieving? Are you doing the best for what is available now? Somebody early in my time in Ireland, of course, used the story about, you know, the usual West Ireland story of you don't have a word as urgent as mañana. Now, I'm telling that quickly because you all know that story. And of course, it's very familiar to me because I used to work in the West Highlands and the Western Isles, the same story. I'm beginning to think Ireland in some areas doesn't have a word as precise as system. And I do think there's aspects of we should be looking at it to make sure there is enough system and the sum of the parts for the fantastic work you do in the early years is making the best possible impact. And I don't think that's a practice issue. I think that's there's been a series in children and family services of management issues. And it's great to see in your documentation very clear what the values are. This to me is crucial. In every presentation, I'll put up this slide because it's how you get on with each other. It's about your relationships. It's about your dependability to each other. It's about how much you trust each other. Are your values clear? Compassion, integrity, justice. These are crucial to the way we take things forward. And to some extent, though, guys, that's the easy bit. The difficult bit is making sure, how does a compassionate person behave? How does a compassionate nursery behave? How does a compassionate school behave? Or a respectful school, or a school that is full of integrity? So we need to take that forward and base it clearly on our systems. And we need to make sure that all the outcomes are being pulled together. I'll pick health from this because it's so often ignored when we're looking at the full range of outcomes. But we want young people who are resilient. Ireland has a crisis in terms of numbers of suicides, which should be a headline in every activity in terms of the number of young people who do not have sufficient resilience to cope because of chaotic lifestyles, dysfunctional families, difficult circumstances, and how do we help them from their very earliest years to build resilience, to have that emotional resilience to go forward, and good decision making. If we were to think of the five things that challenge a young person's health most, it would be to do with diet, it would be to do with fitness, it would be to do with drugs, it would be to do with alcohol and tobacco, it would be to do with having a sense of hope. Now, which of these things would you go to your doctor for? Which of these things would you go to a clinical palace, sometimes known as a hospital? And yet all the attention of the health service is on doctors and hospitals rather than where the action really is. We have moved so far in the last 10 years, and we've also moved so far in the last 100 years. I was at an event in Trinity last week celebrating 300 years of the medical school there. And weren't they pleased with themselves about the change they'd made to the world and to society, and they would be making more change. But the big changes in our health have come through engineers. It's come through clean water. It's come through good decision making. It's come through local government. It's come through sanitation. It's about public health and how we take these things forward. In early years, it's central to that and how we take that forward. So as Avril says, it's how do we have the capacity to ignore the evidence which she's set out? How do we make sure, in terms of our young people, that we're working in partnership with the family and with the parents? It's about extending the learning, not leaving it in a box. How do we get the parents, the mums and the dads, into the early year setting? How do we get them working with us? How do we work with the teenage parents so that they're in that group and not with the elderly prims that are put off, or maybe their mum's pals? How do we put them in environments to make sure there's no chairs in the room so they've actually got to sit down and interact with their very young children? How do we make sure that as we take forward the debate about children's rights, which in Ireland is about the recognition of the fundamental humanity of every citizen, irrespective of ethnicity or gender or age, merely because a particular human being is of a certain age does not mean that they do not have rights. It's a fundamental issue of humanity. It's a fundamental issue of boundaries. I want everybody here to commit to believing in the rights of a four-year-old to be four. Being four is not a preparation for adulthood. We are the adults of tomorrow. Big deal. We are the children of today. Enjoy it. That's what we should be saying to them. You're the children of today. Enjoy it. I implore people to search their language, to look at their system. Let's try and get rid of the term preschool. 0 to 4 is a really exciting, fantastic, joyful time. It is not just a preparation for going to school. And I think we can move beyond that. And four-year-olds have rights. And four-year-olds we have obligations to. And people find a difficulty with that. But clearly, these rights are within boundaries. And these boundaries are normally set by a loving family. And 14-year-olds have rights, and the boundaries are a bit wider. And those of us fortunate to have our grown-up children still staying with us know that the boundaries are even wider. But we still expect them to be reasonable as a flatmate and let us know, you know, which hour of the morning they're returning from any given activity, and to try and not stumble too often in the way in, or remember that they don't need to set the alarm at 3 a.m. But the boundaries are still there. And within those boundaries, we need to make sure that children are safe and that we don't interfere in their humanity within these boundaries in terms of physical abuse, in terms of sexual abuse, and the difficult area, the area of debate, in terms of neglect. So let's take things forward, setting the boundaries that recognise the humanity. Now, I could have looked at Cambridgeshire in a very good mixed economy in early years. I could have looked at Stirling, which I believe, through no work of my own, but through an excellent head of service I worked with there, has outstanding performance. But just as quick reflection, I'm not going to stop in these slides. I'll put some slides up about practice in Italy. You know, tremendous practice in parts of Italy, the centrality of the child respected and trusted. Here in San Miniato, they educate real knives and forks. No protection, use of glass, use of environments that say, we respect you as children. So looking for opportunities and working together, working with the nursery, making it a joint place of learning, looking at how children learn so that they have the basis for learning and resilience throughout their life, making sure, crucially, as we move forward, as we celebrate the government's commitment to children, as we celebrate the political capital that's now available, as we will the government to succeed and they get our unconditional support, we must make sure it's a community development model. Whether it's early years or social work or family support or social care, if you're left to do it on your own, it will not be as good as if it's rooted in the commitment of the whole community. Engaged communities, responsible individuals, inclusive schools. And I suppose that's just my way of saying, yes, we live in difficult times. The state is bankrupt. There are no resources. There has been a lot of resources available, and some of the work will be consolidation. But the future is not inevitable. The future is not necessarily even as set out in the programme for government. The future will be influenced by you engaging with that future and you working to create a conversation between the present and the future and making sure that there are opportunities for you to tell leaders and others where they're getting it wrong and to make sure that the future is influenced by what you've achieved here in Donegal and by your practical wisdom. You know, for your children, again, the reflection on Avril's final slide, life's not a dress rehearsal. Hey guys, this is it. You know, let's be to the moment and get it right. and through your collective efforts and wisdom, you can make a difference. And you can make a difference because, much as the word may be cliched, partnership matters. How do we work together with common goods? I care how my son is educated, not for his own sake, but I care how everybody is educated because I want my son to grow up in a well-educated world. So are we partners? Can we rely on each other? Are we dependable? Can we act together to make an impact and always focusing on the rights and interests of children? So as I can see from your documentation, purpose is clear. Do you know the needs of your community? Are you reliable? Do you make an impact? Are we ready to challenge the concepts of the L'Oreal generation? You know, that it's not just because they're worth it. They've actually got to participate in some of it. We can only provide the best circumstances, or we can provide most effectively for those who engage. It's an action, it's a to and fro with it. So I've come here to try and work with people and pull together what I see as the compelling story, which I've reflected on a little. We need to have clear corporate goals. There's a number of cultural issues here. I would be the sort of guy at a conference that would do knockabout about culture. I was in the Culture Commission in Scotland, you know, to do with the arts, which I'm passionately committed to, but, you know, culture in the work sense. And then I think for penance, I have been sent to Ireland. Gosh, you have cultural issues, church issues, legal issues, HSE poor culture issues, constitutional issues. Culture, we need to talk. We also need to make sure that the bit that's broken and the bit that lacks credibility is child protection. There is no child protection system in Ireland. We need to create one. We need to gather together. We need to have the debate. There needs to be consistency. We need to complete the reform to make sure we're providing the best possible service for our children, the 5,500 children for whom we have corporate care responsibility. We then need to get back on the front foot, to get back upstream, to stop children falling in the river, never mind fishing them out, in terms of earlier intervention and family support. For all the reports that told us the past wasn't really very good, I inherited 68 or 69 different change groups. I've rationalised that into 7 programmes and taking that forward in a more disciplined way and working with the new department, making sure that the changes we do now are fit for purpose for the new government's aspiration and all underpinned by our values, by how we behave, and all challenged by your knowledge, your experience, your collective wisdom. I'm happy to take one or two questions if there are a moment or two, though I know you're really dying for your coffee, so I'm taking the easy option. But this sheet, which is trying to sum up the last bit about the change programme. So if there are any immediate questions, by all means, happy to take them. I'll understand if there aren't, and it'll be about over coffee. Thank you. Me too.
With someone like you at the helm in the new department, I just think it gives us all a great heart because you speak the language that we speak on the ground, and to know that somebody at the top is speaking our language is absolutely brilliant. So we'll all look forward to it.